Welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. My guest today, Manil Suri, has written a novel that will hold you all the way through actually terrorism, anger, fighting, and yet a love story. The book is called The City of Devi. It's published by W.W. Norton. Welcome, Manil.
Thank you, Connie.
And it is a book that takes place in Bombay, Mumbai.
Yes, I mean, the two names for the city, and I grew up calling it Bombay, but in the early 90s, it changed to Mumbai, and I go from one to the other, so in this talk, I'll probably use them both.
Right. And the story, the city of Devi, Devi is a goddess, but there is also Super Devi.
Yes. So Devi is, the word Mumbai comes from Mumba and I, which both mean mother, and Mumba Devi is the patron goddess of the city. But there is a film called Super Devi, a Bollywood film that is sort of part Slumdog Millionaire, part Superman, and that's taken over the world.
And the woman, Sarita, she's 31, she has a master's degree. She is probably, according to Indian mothers, overeducated.
Mm-hmm.
She is a Hindu,
right.
Family is Hindi, and her sister, her younger sister, has married.
Yes.
And they are trying to find a suitable boy for Sarita, which I think was also almost the title of another Indian book.
Uh-huh. A suitable boy, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, so Sarita is a little unsure about her own attractiveness as a result.
Yeah.
She's been through all these searches for a boy, and so when she meets Karun, and he's, you know, sounds like a possibility, she kind of invests all her chances for happiness in him.
And he is shy, he is a perfect gentleman, and eventually they decide they will marry.
Yes, so they do get married, and it's a marriage that, you know, for a couple of years, it doesn't quite pan out the way that Sarita hopes. It doesn't quite get consummated in the way that she hopes.
Yeah. But it is enough that they can play around with each other that seems to be enough satisfaction. And for a woman who had not known anybody, this is almost enough.
Yes, and Sarita is actually a statistician, so she invents this elaborate way of giving stars depending on how successful she is every night.
Yep.
And she calculates a standard deviation and weird things like that.
But she starts to investigate, who is my husband? What is he like? And she goes through his clothes, goes through everything, and then discovers a suitcase under the bed.
Yes, and that just has, it turns out, memories of his own parents. But that doesn't quite unlock the mystery, and it's only when the city kind of splits apart and she has to find him once he's disappeared. He's disappeared for 18 days. That she not only wants to find him, but she also wants to discover what has been going on with her marriage.
Yeah, and throughout the book, the pomegranate plays a big role.
Yes.
Because she knew he loved that pomegranate.
Mm-hmm.
And even when a woman almost has her arrested, attacked, and claims she's a Muslim, she's
right.
not a Hindu,
right.
that she suddenly realizes that she must keep this pomegranate for Karun.
Yes, somehow she feels that this pomegranate is going to unlock some of the secrets of her marriage.
Yeah.
And on the one hand, it's a very kind of, it's supposed to be an aphrodisiac according to
yeah.
the Kama Sutra, but really the way it reveals things is a very different way. It's not exactly what you would think.
Tell me about the politics at that time, because bombs are exploding, fires are being set, America is being destroyed, London is being attacked. The whole idea of cataclysmic.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I mean, it's one of those things where it's almost the perfect storm, where India and Pakistan have gone to war. Pakistan is threatening a nuclear attack. But then, unfortunately, instead of the West stepping in to save them and calm things
mm-hmm.
down, they get embroiled in their own problems. There's cyber attacks, and you know they just cannot interfere. And so it gets to the edge.
Yeah.
And so there's only 4 days left before the world might end. So what are you going to do in those 4 days?
Yeah. And she now, having been, I guess, in a London underground when the bombs were
mm-hmm.
coming, and they start to attack a man.
Right.
And she says, no, He's not Muslim. He's not Muhammad. He's one of us. I know him.
Yes, so she kind of steps forward and she saves this person who she suspects might be a Muslim, and because these people are going to lynch him otherwise. Yeah. And then you know, something happens. Yeah. And you know, everything.
And then, of course, I mean, what's interesting is that in order the Hindus, in order to prove someone's a Muslim, take your pants off. It almost was like what happened with Nazi Germany.
Yes,
for the Jews.
Yeah, and you know, India has a history of that kind of religious violence. I mean, the country used to be one with Pakistan, and at some point it was divided in 1947, and a lot of people died, 500,000 people. So, you know, there is this undercurrent that's always in the background, and so that's one of the things that could again recur here.
Yeah, and it seems to be.
Yes, but on the other hand, you know, there's also this whole idea of the end of the earth, love, finding love at the end of the earth, because all of this is actually a way of making these characters take risks that they wouldn't otherwise to find the people that they love.
And my friend, the author, has done it in such a way that each of the characters has their own voice.
Yes.
Yeah.
So so there is Sarita that we've talked about, and then the other character, probably my favorite, is Jazz. He's called the Jazzter.
Yeah.
And he is he's Muslim, so unlike Sarita, who's Hindu, and he's also gay. So and he's very open about his sexuality, and he's actually grown up all over the world.
Yeah.
So he's very worldly, and he's very irreverent. He has this great sense of humor.
And his parents seem to go along with it. They have traveled all over, and they have taken him there.
Yes, they've traveled. They're Islamic scholars. They've come up with a new theory of Islam. So they've been very much in demand all over the world. And he's had all these emotional problems, and around his 14th or 15th birthday, he finally discovers what really is going on, and that is his own sexuality.
Yeah.
Once he discovers that, it's very liberating for him.
Yeah. And he has a cousin who was part of it.
Yes, yes. They have a great time, and I love that scene because, you know, they try out all these pantry ingredients to do all sorts of experiments, let's say.
And they're left alone in the house.
Yes, and so they're, you know, like boys will, I guess, play with each other and everything. So that's what leads to Jazz emerging as a whole person to himself.
And he refers to himself as the Jazzter.
Yes.
It's almost as if he has a split personality.
Right, the Jazzter is the hip, you know, it's like hipster and so on.
Yeah.
So he's always looking at him and calling himself in the third person.
But he has a falling. He fell in love with Karun.
Yes. So, I mean, throughout his life, the Jazzter has, you know, basically existed for sex more than anything else. And so when he finally finds love, he doesn't even realize it.
Yeah.
And he doesn't realize it, and it's too late. And he loses the one person that he loves. And so at this juncture, again, he too is finding, he's searching for the one he loves.
And during this period, it's also where he and Karun take an apartment, and a woman who is a widow but has a rotten son living there says, look, almost in a sense, no games. I know who you guys are.
Yeah, and that's one of the interesting things about, you know, how gay people are perceived in India. On the one hand, it's a very conservative society. On the other hand, you know, people are very accommodating too. So even the people downstairs, the fruit seller and the vegetable seller, they all look at these two as a couple, as a male couple. So that's how they treat them.
Yeah. What part does being, I should tell our friends that you are a professor of mathematics.
That's true.
At the University of
Maryland, Baltimore County, UMBC.
Why all of those counties?
That's because there's so many different campuses, and we are very sensitive about which campus, you know, I belong to.
I see. And what type of mathematics do you teach?
I teach everything from calculus up. We even have a graduate program, so I will teach those courses as well. I think of late, I've been trying to combine the writing and the math. You know, I feel that mathematicians need to do outreach a little bit. So I think I've taken my first step with this book. I didn't put a mathematician as a character, but I made Sarita a statistician.
Yeah, she is.
I figured that would be more palatable to people.
Uh-huh.
I don't want to scare anyone.
It's far, far from it.
Okay.
As the world is changing, she has to escape, really, from Bombay or Mumbai?
Yes, in the city, if you look at the city, it's a very north to south city, and Bombay used to be seven islands and they were filled in. And so these characters they walk from the south part all the way to the north, and they take a train in the middle. There's also an elephant that helps them. And they're basically looking not just for Karun, but also for the Super Devi, who has somehow, you know, from this movie, there's a manifestation that has somehow descended to Earth. And this mother goddess is saying, I'm going to save the city. Now, the mother goddess can either destroy the city or save the city. We don't know what will happen.
And she is pulled onto a train by a woman who says, come, you'll be one of the ladies in waiting, so to speak.
Exactly. And they've got these magical saris that glow in the dark. And so all the young girls are very excited that they're going to be part of this Super Devi's retinue.
Now, they are being readied for a man named Bhim.
Bhim, yes.
Bhim.
Yes. And Bhim is this sort of shady person who's
a little mafia.
He's one of the people who has caused this split of the country into Hindu and Muslim areas. He's basically a very right-wing politician who has turned rogue in some sense and who has resorted to a lot of violence. And he controls the city, essentially.
Yeah. What is HRM?
HRM is the Hindu Rashtra Manch, and it's a fictitious right-wing party. It doesn't exist, actually, but it is something that has been one of the main instigators in the book for this kind of violence for political reasons. You know, they want to have political gain, and so they turn religions against each other.
It's amazing how no matter what generation or country, it's almost like, Nazi Germany.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I mean, that's one of the things that, you know, just my own parents, actually, they used to live in Pakistan before the partition, and they had to just flee and just save their lives and come to India because they were Hindu.
Yeah, because I've heard the other side of the story, too, where people who were living in India but were Muslims.
Yes, they had to go to Pakistan. And so it's... you know, India and Pakistan form this, in the book, they actually form a triangle with China, which is sort of the third party in all of this geopolitical game. And of course, all three countries have nuclear capability. So in that sense, it's a very frightening area. As long as things are kept under control, we're fine. But, you know, in this situation, something else could happen.
Speaking as a mathematician, the role of the triangle.
That, you know, emerged as I was, I had given up on this book. Yeah. You know, there's so many strands, there's pomegranates, elephants, this, that. I just could not make it work. And at some point, this was in 2009, actually, after working on it for many years, I suddenly realized the thing that had eluded me. And this is, you know, being a mathematician, I should see a triangle right away. But I didn't. I did not see Sarita, Karun, and Jazz forming this triangle, just like the three deities in Hinduism, Vishnu, Shiva, and the mother goddess, Devi, they also form a triangle. And so there was this deep metaphor in the book. And once I saw that, I said, okay, I have to get these three strands together, combine them literally. And that's what enabled me to finish the book.
Yeah. Even the fact that if one fell out, there was somebody else who would fill in.
Exactly. So the concept of this triangle actually keeps changing. You know, initially it's a triangle that Karun forms with his mother and father, and then later on it comes to something else. So it's a very interesting thing that kept recurring, a motif that kept recurring in the book.
Manu, would you read from the book? It's not
absolutely
doesn't do with the story, but it does do with what was going on around them within the political structure.
Sure. 5 weeks later, the Jaster still marvels at how quick and easy it was to unravel the order of the entire world. First came the news